I think we had discussed the estimating costs part, isn't it, in the previous session? Now we are coming to the next part, that is analyzing this last point. I think it was remaining, analyzing competitors' costs, prices, and offers. Now, within the range of possible prices determined by the market demand and company costs, now here the firm must take into account the competitors' costs. What are their prices? What are the perceptions of the customers towards the competitors' pricing? Is there any differentiation strategy adopted by the competitors while setting the price? Or whether they are offering something which is non-monetary attached to it, like extra volume of the product, or maybe travel coupons, discount coupons. Now here, the company has to have a look at their own position while thinking about the pricing strategy as compared to the competitors. Whether the product quality of the company with the competitors, does it match, or whether there is some differentiation offered by the competitor. So these things have to be taken into consideration while taking into account the pricing part. Now here, if one thinks of just following the competitors, okay, that would not be a good stand here. Because the competitors, if they have the strength, they may think of changing the price. Maybe suddenly the competitors can come up with the combined package offers, which is not possible for this firm. So better take into account the analysis and then decide about the pricing strategies here. Now we move ahead with the next step, that is selecting the pricing method. This is a very important step in the price determination. Now we are looking into the customer's demand schedule, the cost function, and the competitor's pricing. The company has to decide its own pricing strategy. Now there are some methods which a company can follow. So just now we will go through these methods in detail. What are these methods? Exactly. Now it depends upon the individual company to adapt to a pricing method. Now first, if you see, it's a markup pricing method. Now this is a very popular method. It is also known as the cost plus pricing method. The other name for this is cost plus pricing. Now here, as the name suggests, okay, a standard markup or a profit is added to the product cost. So here, if we consider the fixed cost plus variable cost and profit margin is added. So basically here, some amount forms the base of profit margin, which is added to the basic cost of the product. Now, if you have seen the professions, the businesses, the professions, like we can take an example of interior designing, okay, or the architectural firms, those who take the contracts, okay, there they use such type of method. That is, they add a markup or percentage. How much is the work done? What would be the pricing of the total work done? To that, maybe they just take some share, some percentage as a profit margin for the work done by them. Now, markups are generally higher on seasonal items. Why? Because to cover the risk of not selling in future. Specialty items, slower moving items, or items with high storage and handling costs. And demand inelasticity, inelastic items, like, you know, prescription of drugs. Now here one takes into consideration the basic cost, that is fixed cost plus some variable cost, and the sales expected in terms of consumer goods or consumer products here. Now, companies introducing a new product, okay, in the market, they often take this method into consideration to recover costs in a speedy way, specifically when the product enters into the introductory stage, when it is newly introduced in the market. That is, in the PLC, if you see the first part, that is new product introduction part, the companies introduce this type of pricing strategy. Now here, it offers the flexibility. Since there are many forces which are affecting the market, the markup rate can be flexible. So here, one can think of hiring or lowering it based upon the other variables which affect the basic price. Maybe tomorrow, if the price of the raw material increases, then one can think of increasing the margin. Or if the price of the raw material decreases and the goods is at a cheaper rate, then that is basic cost of the product goes down, and in that case lower margins. So here this offers, this type of pricing method offers the flexibility. That is one very important advantage as far as this pricing method is considered. Now here the sellers determines cost much more easily than they can estimate demand in this case. Now whenever a marketer wants to recover the costs at a speedy rate, very rapidly, so it is possible by this method. It's very simple because you just calculate the cost plus some margin, some profit, and that becomes the end price of the product. So here the calculation is very simple. It's not complicated. Now here, if you take into consideration the products with the similar, or the offerings with the similar quality, okay, all the products the competitors, they are offering with the here and there on the same grounds, the price tends to be similar. So here, through this, by adopting this pricing method, the competition is minimized or avoided to a certain extent. Now this is fair, or this is advantageous for both the buyers as well as the sellers, both of them. Because for buyers, you know, for customers, it gives a uniform pricing platform. There is no much variation for comparative analysis as far as the price benchmark is considered for the customers. and for the sellers, because everybody enjoys their own market share and they are equal partners in the business as far as the profits are considered. So it's a win-win situation for both the parties. So here the competition is minimized, which otherwise is not possible. And in competition, you also know that it ends up most of the revenues while promoting the products. Many of the companies, they invest a lot on promotional things like advertising, which eats up a major portion of the revenues or profits. Now here only the limitation is that the it ignores the consumer's perception of price. Here the sales parts is difficult. One cannot guarantee about the sales figure. So this is the limitation part of the method, of this method. Now the next is the target return pricing. Now, as the name suggests, it is target return. The firm determines the price that would yield its target rate of return on investment. Okay. So here the company takes into account the return on investment as the basis for determining the price of the offering or of the product. Now here, for the firms, those who are eager to recover the investment costs, okay, for them it is more profitable when the companies think of recovering the invested amount. Like the formula would be like target return price is equal to unit cost, that is cost of per unit of the product plus desired return into invested capital divided by unit sales. So here the company takes into consideration this type of pricing by taking into account the returns on the invested capital plus the unit cost in proportion to the sale of the units. Now mostly, you know, the government companies or the public utilities, the cooperative societies, and other similar type of organizations where their basic objective is to get the return on the investment. That is the first and foremost objective of pricing. They go for such type of the method. They undertake this method. Now here, this is possible when the company is capable of estimating the accuracy of the sales, the variable cost as well as the fixed cost, then only it is possible. If the company achieves the expected sales, then only undertaking such type of pricing method is meaningful. Otherwise, it's not worth going for such type of method. Now here much depends on the price elasticity and the competitor's pricing strategy here also. It tends to ignore now this, when one thinks of target return pricing, it thinks of ignoring the aspects of price elasticity or the competitor strategy here in this case. In target price return. Now here, the manufacturers needs to think about the different prices and the estimate their probable impact on sales volume and profits. The manufacturer should also search for the ways to lower its fixed cost as well as variable cost, because lower cost will decrease the its required break-even volume actually here. So this is about the target return pricing. Now moving ahead with the perceived value pricing. Now an increasing number of companies, they base the price on the customer's perceived value. This method is the market oriented method for setting the price. Now here the basic foundation is laid on the consumer's perceived value of the product. That is the equation of amount paid to the value received or the benefit received by the customers. Okay, that trade-off is taken into account or taken into consideration while setting the final price of the offering. So the customer's opinion and their thought is given the priority as compared to the company's own cost, its other objectives. They are given this second priority. The company tries to understand the views and opinions of the buyers here regarding the price of the product. It takes into consideration the benefit of the product, any new features offered to the customers, its brand image, the reputation of the brand or the company, whether it's the new one, which is maybe a offering is newly introduced, or there are competitors. So here there are many attributes which are taken into consideration. Now here the important thing is perceived value pricing method of is to measure accurately the market's perception of offer's value. In what way does the customer thinks about the offer's value? Now for this, a strong market research is needed. These companies take the helping hand of the marketing research here, because ultimately when you are studying the consumers, what do they think, what are their perceptions? So marketing research comes into picture. So unless and until you have the market research done accurately, one cannot think of having this perceived value pricing. So first and foremost, very important thing, it is from the customer point of view. It does not consider the competitors or other criteria here. When you take directly the customers into consideration as far as the price goes, that is one basic assumption that you are dealing with the facts here, because the customers are those who are going to purchase the products, obviously. So here this is taken, the perceived value is taken as a base, and with the very less adjustment in the costs and objectives, a suitable price is set or offered to the customers. However, see, when the company thinks of customers, okay, customers are again the human being. Each and every person has their own individual perceptions towards the market. So when the marketing research is considered, it becomes very difficult for the market research, the research department to consider the whole masses. One cannot think of having a unique segment here. Each and every individual has their own way of thinking. So that is one limitation as far as this method goes. Now here again, second thing is, who is dealing with the perception of the buyers? Who is looking into the matter? Whether they are researchers or the salesperson, okay, there may be a possibility of bias. Okay, because whatever is the information shared by these maybe dealers, retailers, the employees, the sales force task, okay, is collected by this marketing department. So again, believing on that data and moving ahead and coming up with the price is a bit challenging here. So that's why we say that this method is also based on the trust, because ultimately in marketing research, the employees are trusted, the dealers are trusted, the retailers are trusted, and the customers who are taken as the samples, even they should give the appropriate answers or reveal what are their feelings. These are some of the limitations as far as the perceived value pricing is considered. So the next is the value pricing. Now here, value pricing now, many companies have adopted this value pricing in which they charge a fairly low price or a high quality offering or a high quality offering. Now this says that the price should represent a high value offer to consumers. Now if you take the best example of this is a retail business. If you take the offers by Big Bazaar or the king of the retail, that is Walmart, or any other retailer, for instance. Okay. Now here an important type. Now one of the important type you might have come across. Maybe you might have come across in the newspapers, or the messages, or on the television through the advertising, is the everyday low pricing, which takes place at the retail level. Basically, such type of methods, they are applied in the retail part, retailer's business. Now, a retailer holds an everyday low pricing policy, which charges a constant everyday low price with no temporary price discounts. Now these constant prices eliminate week-to-week price uncertainty and can be contrasted to a high-low pricing of promotion-oriented competitors. So maybe if you consider the Big Bazaar, they have the Wednesday, they give some offers, Sabse Sasta offer, okay? Such type of themes they have. So that is what it comes into this category, falls into this category of value pricing. And people, they are easily influenced by such type of promotions. Now retailers adapt this strategy for number of reasons, like for the sake of constant sales or motivating the customers, promoting them. Okay.
और जैसे educational information जानने के लिए आप हमारे Telegram channel पे भी join हो और YouTube को भी subscribe कर दीजिए, channel को subscribe.
So here, within a less span of time, the companies, these retailers, grab the market share. They can retain more customers. By including the price as one of the important promotional tool. Next thing is to gain customer loyalty. Now, by having such type of pricing method, they can gain the customer loyalty. They are able to place the customers near to them. They draw the shoppers to their premises. So if you see many of the offers, maybe during the weekends and all, they go for such type of offers. Now in the change scenario, okay, value pricing, if we see in the change scenario, many of you might have observed that today people, they cannot go in the shopping malls to shop. Okay. So here, the concept of metaspaces has come into existence, online marketing. Okay, they adopt such type of pricing method. If we see the shopping websites, the companies like Amazon, Snapdeal, Flipkart, everybody, they use this method, you know, to promote the sales. Let's see, here only the limitation is it can be a short-term, to achieve the short-term goal. It's not feasible for all of the products in the bundle. It works more for the seasonal products. It works more for the, you know, convenience goods, more or less. Not for the shopping type of goods or shopping type of products much. Though today, because of the internet revolution, we can see many changes. People are accepting, okay, part of intangibility, which is a basic drawback in this online shopping, or a limitation we can say, but still people are accepting it. Now moving ahead is the going rate pricing. Going rate, or it is also called as the competitive parity method. The other name for this is competitive parity method. As the name suggests, going rate, the rate which is ongoing among all the companies. That is, even the competitors are offering the good at the same price. Now here, the companies give less priority to its own cost, to basic objectives, to the demand of the offering, but it is based on the competitor's pricing strategy. Now here, in this type of pricing method, there is less scope as far as the differentiation part is considered, because wherever there is differentiation, then there is a possibility of having some uniqueness and the prices go up. But here again, we take into consideration the convenience goods, which are, they are consumed on day-to-day basis. Follow the leader, or the leader is right. That is what is the notion which is being followed by most of the companies. Now here, when it is difficult to set the price initially, and there are competitors, the product is not new in the market, there are already the other competitors existing in the market, then only such type of pricing methods are justified. That is the first thing. Second thing is, considers the competitors as the base. Third thing is that it brings the same pricing or uniform pricing method. So as it has a uniform pricing, it is more beneficial for the customers because they get more choice of the offering because the prices are same, only the brands differ. For the sellers, it becomes difficult to mark their own identity. So that is one of the demerit. The second thing is that companies' individual objectives, or the cost, or the quality, services, you know, the to gain the attention of the customers becomes challenging for the customers here, for the company, sorry. Yeah. Because what the customer will pursue, since the prices are on the same lines, it becomes very difficult for the companies to differentiate here or to portray that they are somewhere they differ from the crowd. So initially the company may think of copying the competitors and slowly and steadily may move to the some other pricing method here in this ongoing rate pricing. Now the next method is the sealed bid pricing method. Now the firm bases its price on expectations of how competitors will price rather than on the relation of firm's cost or demand. So here also the company does not take into consideration the basic cost or the demand. Okay, here whenever the company takes into consideration such type of method, it thinks from the competitor's point of view. This is also known as the tender pricing, which is more, one will find this type of pricing methods into the government sector, those who are supplying into the government or the private organizations also. Now here usually the process is that maybe the tender notice is published through the newspapers or through the circulars. So here it is open, the clients, they just disclose it openly about their requirements in detail. Maybe what are their requirements, if it is with reference to either machinery or maybe completion of the work, contract to be given for the completion of any type of work. So here the time frame, the basic costing or the quality, everything is specified, okay? So everybody knows what are the expectations of these clients. Everybody is clear about it. Now, in response to this tender notice published in the newspapers, the interested suppliers, okay, or the interested parties, they have to fill the tender. They have to enclose it in the sealed envelope, the quotations, the price. Now here always there is a competition among these suppliers as far as the price is considered, because it is one of the important factors considered. So based upon this, these tenders are submitted and at a particular date, these envelopes are opened. And then the most favorable supplier with the lower price and the average quality, which matches the specifications given by the company, is selected. Now here the rate of the selected bid is the price for the particular job or product. Now here such type of method is adapted usually when basically mostly in case of industrial buying, one can say when the orders are more, when the procurement is more, as far as the items or goods are considered, then only they think of the sealed bid pricing, or maybe for non-profit organizations also. Now it is about the, this is about the selecting the pricing method. Now after the company selects a particular price, okay, the last step is final price, deciding the final price. Now these pricing methods, they narrow the range from which the company must select its final price. So here, you know, the companies are narrowing and zeroing upon one particular method to finalize the price. Now here the company must also consider the additional factors like the other pricing attributes like psychological pricing, the influence of other marketing mix elements on the price, the company's pricing policy itself, and the impact of price on other parties. What would be the impact of pricing strategies on the other parties? That has to be considered by the companies or by the manufacturers. So this is again the additional part. Now here, if you consider the psychological pricing, so many consumers use price as an indicator of quality. So whenever we are also just purchasing any of the product, we just have a look at the price, because psychologically somewhere we are just thinking about the price and the ingredients or the elements which are the inputs for the offering. So here we start our calculations. Then and there itself, but why this might be the price? Let us see if there is something new or something additional in the price. Now here the price and quality perceptions, they do interact with each other. When looking at a particular product, the buyers, they carry some reference price formed by noticing the current prices, the past price. So psychologically, the people, they always are, it's inbuilt that they think about the calculations which are always taking place as a trade-off between what they are paying and what they are getting. So here the manufacturers take these things into account and decide the pricing mechanism. Now the sellers often manipulate these reference prices. Like for example, a seller can situate its product among expensive products to imply that it belongs to the same class, in the same class. Or the department stores will display the apparels in separate departments differentiated by price. So we do come across such type of experience, that they have the separate departments in the stores. So the prices are differentiated. Somewhere if you see the better quality and more, with the more price they are placed, while at the other end you will see the lower price quality. Maybe you perceive that they may be inferior and this may be more superior. So reference price thinking is also created by stating a high manufacturer's suggested price, or by indicating that the product was priced much higher originally, or by pointing to a competitor's high price. Now here, if you see, as far as the psychological pricing is considered, many sellers believe that the prices, they should end with the odd numbers. Now if you see, Bata, I think, was the first who introduced this. Okay. They don't have the round figures. 199, 299, 499. Okay. So this is the due to the psychological pricing. So here, the basic objective is that when we say it's a price of 399 or 299, somewhere psychologically the customer feels that it is not crossing that whole number. That is, if it is 300, okay, 300 is more as compared to that 299 becomes a bit less. So this is the psychology. You see that this is also copied by other competitors, other companies. Also, another reason for this type of odd endings is the notion of a discount or a bargain. Okay. Maybe the people perceive it as a bargain. Now here, if the companies, they need or they tend to move towards high price image instead of low price image, they should avoid such type of psychological pricing. So again, this depends upon the type of commodity. If it is a shopping good or a luxurious goods, one cannot think of having perceived value pricing. They are only feasible for day-to-day goods, consumer goods, or the convenience goods. Now, the influence of other marketing mix elements. Now, here, the final price should also consider the brand's quality, the advertising relative to the competitors. Now, here, the brands with average relative quality but high advertising budgets, you know, they are able to charge the premium prices here. Now, customers usually are willing to pay higher prices for the known products than the unknown products. If the customer is aware about the product, maybe through word of mouth publicity or through advertising, they will pay. But if the product is or offering is unknown, they are reluctant initially because they cannot judge the quality of the product. They don't have any basic idea of the product. Now, brands with high relative quality and high relative advertising, they obtain the higher prices here as compared to the low quality and low advertising. So we see a positive relationship between high prices and high advertising, which are held more strongly in the later stages of the PLC, okay, specifically for the market leaders. So here, the influence of other marketing elements should also be taken into consideration. If the product is in the introduction stage, it's newly introduced, it involves higher advertising costs, which are passed on to the customers. So one cannot think of lowering the price initially. Once they achieve the economies of the scales, then only the companies can think of lowering the prices here. Now the rest part we will discuss in the next session. Small part is left out, which we will discuss in the next session. Today we will stop here. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, any doubts?
No, ma'am.
Okay.